السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد. Today's topic from Riyad al-Salihin, from the chapter on Mujahada. Very interesting topic. It's about a long life. So this hadith is narrated by Abu Safwan Abdullah ibn Busr al-Aslami radiallahu anhu, who says, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ خَيْرُ النَّاسِ مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ خَيْرُ النَّاسِ مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ. The best of people are those whose lives are long and whose deeds are good. This hadith is narrated by At-Tirmidhi. So again, the best of people are those whose lives are very long and whose deeds are very good. Now, looking at an analysis of the takhrij of this tradition of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, it's narrated by two companions in this particular version, and the same meaning has been narrated by a number of other companions. This particular version narrated by Abdullah ibn Busr al-Aslami and al-Harith al-Nafir ibn al-Harith al-Thaqafi radiallahu anhu. And both of these ahadith are in Tirmidhi, in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, and as well as other collections like Kanzul Umal and Mishkatul Masabih. So looking at the entire hadith, Abdullah ibn Busr, he says that one day he was standing with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and this is the entire hadith. Sometimes in books of hadith, they narrate just the meaning or just a statement of the Prophet, skipping the details. So when you look at the entire text, this particular companion and as well as the other companion, they say that one day they were standing with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam when some Bedouins came to him. And in one of the narrations, there was two Bedouins. And the Bedouins, they were known for what? They were known for their manner was not as refined as the people who lived in the cities. So actually the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, they loved the Bedouins. Why? Because they would be frank and they would be blunt, and they would ask things that were on their mind without thinking twice. The companions themselves, they would hesitate. They had that shyness with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. But whenever they saw a Bedouin come to the Prophet, he would stand up and ask things in the middle of any occasion. So this was one particular person, we don't know his name, but this Bedouin, it is narrated that he stood up and he said, Ya Muhammad, man khayrun nasi ya Muhammad. Oh Muhammad, tell us who's the best of people. And you can imagine the style of the Bedouins. It's like today it would be, hey Muhammad, who is the best of people? That's exactly what they said. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, without getting annoyed in the least, without getting upset, showing his perfect patience, he answered that question. And he said, خَيْرُ النَّاسِ مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ. The best of people are those whose lives are long and whose deeds are good. And in the version in Mishkat al-Masabih, the Prophet answered the question by saying, طُوبَ لِمَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَحَسُنَ عَمَلُهُ. Glad tidings to the one whose life is long and whose deeds are good. And in some of these narrations, the Bedouins asked the second question, so who's the worst of people? And the Prophet answered, مَنْ طَالَ عُمُرُهُ وَسَاءَ عَمَلُهُ. Those whose lives are long and their deeds are evil. And in one of the narrations, the Bedouin asked a third question, which was, أَيُّ الْأَعْمَالِ أَفْضَلِ. Which of the deeds is the best? So what is the best deed? So first question was, who's the best person? And who's the worst person? And then he asked, what's the best deed? And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, أَن تُفَارِقَ الدُّنْيَا وَلِسَانُكَ رَطْبٌ مِنْ ذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. That you leave this world while your tongue is moist and wet with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a beautiful tradition we have before us. Now the same meaning, just to mention, is narrated by other companions on other occasions. Jabir ibn Abdullah, he narrates that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, خِيَارُكُمْ أَطْوَلُكُمْ أَعْمَارًا وَأَحْسَنُكُمْ أَعْمَالًا. So the Prophet said on another occasion the same meaning. The best of you are those whose lives are the longest and their character is the best, meaning their deeds are the best. So the same meaning, those who have the longest lives and the best deeds. Abu Huraira narrates a version, خِيَارُكُمْ أَطْوَلُكُمْ أَعْمَارًا وَأَحْسَنُكُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The best of you are those whose lives are the longest and their character is the best. So these are the different ways the Prophet taught this lesson, and all these different narrations are authentic. They're authenticated by Shaykh Nasiruddin al-Albani rahimahullah and other scholars of hadith. So what are we talking about here? We're talking about a long life. A long life is one of the greatest blessings in this world. And every human being can attest to that. It's one of those things we aspire to. Which human being wants to live a short life? Every single person, no matter where he lives or what time, wants to live a long life. It's one of the greatest blessings that we can enjoy. And the Quran mentions even some people, they want to live 1,000 years or more, right? The verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, part of the verse, يَوَدُّ أَحَدُهُمْ لَوْ يُعَمَّرُ أَلْفَ سَنَةً. That's one of them, or some of them, they want to live for 1,000 years. So this is the nature of human beings, that we crave a long life, and there's nothing wrong with that. It's a great blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the Prophet here, he mentioned two things. That's the point for us. He mentioned two things in this hadith. One of those things is mostly out of our control. And the other thing he mentioned is mostly within our control. What's out of our control is our lifespan, umr, lifespan, how many years we live. We generally don't control how long we live, although we would like to. Even in today's times, with all this technology and science and modern medicine, still to this day we can't control how long we live. Although there's so much effort into researching that, there's so much money being spent, so many advertisements, so many fields devoted to helping people live longer. And there's a term for that in the medical profession called longevity. Longevity is the length of a person's life. And there's even, I've seen some clinics with my own eyes where they call them longevity centers, where doctors open these clinics where they help you live longer. But we as believers, you know, we know that the lifespan, there's nothing, is beyond our control, mostly beyond our control. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ السَّاعَةِ. He mentions at the end of Surah Al-Luqman, 5 things, the knowledge of which is only with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What are those 5 things? He says that the knowledge of the Day of Judgment. And among those things is the knowledge of what is in the wombs. Among those things, the knowledge of what a person will earn tomorrow. And among those things is the knowledge of which land you will die. In other words, your lifespan. How long you're going to live, how long you're going to die. وَمَا تَدْرِي نَفْسٌ بِأَيِّ أَرْضٍ تَمُوتُ. No person knows in what land he or she shall die. So this is part of the knowledge that's with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's a matter of theology and belief for the Muslims that we don't believe that we can prolong our life any second beyond Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what He decreed for us. Allah says in the Quran, فَإِذَا جَاءَ أَجَلُهُمْ لَا يَسْتَأْخِرُونَ سَاعَةً وَلَا يَسْتَقْدِمُونَ. When the time comes for a person or a nation or a community's death or their end, no one can delay that even a sa'a, a moment of time, or bring it forward a moment of time. So really all of this talk about longevity and lifespan, there's an obsession in our society with that. And it's really misleading as believers, as Muslims, and as people of experience and religion. We know that these things aren't absolute. So when anyone tries to sell you something about living longer, know that, you know, you have to take that with a grain of salt. Now they even have applications on the iPhone and all these phone, smartphones, where you plug in your age, your waist, and your weight, and all of these things, and it tells you your lifespan. And even you put in how many packs of cigarettes you smoke, it changes that according to set calculations. So really, this is very problematic. And, you know, there's so many examples of people, you know, where doctors give them time to live and, you know, they're living beyond that. I visited my grandparents a few days ago in North Carolina. Both of them more than 90 years old. They're parents of my mother, my maternal grandparents. 6 months ago, they were very, very ill, and the doctors in the hospital told them they had a few days left to live. And all of them, they were unanimous. They said, you know, you only have a few hours, maybe a few days at the most. And they asked our family to make preparations, tell us which funeral home you want to go to, and so on and so forth. Our family opted to bring our grandparents home. And we said, look, we don't believe in that stuff. You know, we'll see when that time comes, we'll talk. It's more than 6 months later when all the doctors of those hospitals gave them this verdict, and they're still alive, alhamdulillah. We ask Allah to give them and all of us shifa and a good ending. So really, the lifespan is beyond our control, mostly beyond our control. But the second thing the Prophet mentioned, alayhi salatu wasalam, and this is the lesson for us, that we don't control the length of our life. But what we do control is what we do with our lives. So the work that we do, the deeds that we do in our life. So the Prophet was reminding us that the best of you are those whose lives are very long. But at the same time, not only that, with those lives, not only the quantity of their life is long, but the quality of that life is very good. In other words, we do good deeds with this life. So it's not really how long we live as believers, it's what we do with our lives. So it's not really how many years we live to the end, but what we do with our lives. What we do, what kind of deeds we perform, and what was the content of those lives, of the lives that we live. So that's really the point of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, I said that there are two things that he mentioned. One of them is mostly out of our control, and one of them is mostly within our control. Now, why did I use that term mostly? Because sometimes even as believers, we need to understand things properly. So in terms of our deeds, for instance, we shouldn't be in the confusion or the misunderstanding that we control our deeds even 100%. That we're masters of our destiny entirely. That everything that we do is because of what we did. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us and experience tells us that even the deeds that we perform, many of those things are beyond our control. Just to give you some examples. For instance, now just looking at the deeds that we perform. For instance, there's a beautiful hadith where the Prophet reminded us that praying in Masjid al-Aqsa is worth how many prayers? Praying in Masjid al-Aqsa is worth how many prayers? 5,000. 5,000 prayers to pray in this masjid. So it's a sunnah. It's a sunnah to pray in that masjid. Now how many of us have the opportunity to do that? We might have the intention. We might want to do this good deed. But most of us, this route is closed. I remember when we made Hajj, it was part of our plan to stop in Jordan, and we did for a few days. And part of the itinerary, we had the planning, and it was advertised that way. We were going to take the bus across the road into Jerusalem and try to pray at least some of the salat in Masjid al-Aqsa. But what happened, the border was closed, as is often the case, and nobody was allowed in. And so the whole stay we had, 2 to 3 days, we weren't able to do what we planned. So the point is, there are many deeds that are beyond our control, that we might want to perform them, but we can't because of circumstances beyond our control. Hajj and Umrah, for instance, is very, very expensive. You know, perhaps the majority of the Muslim Ummah is not able to afford Hajj or Umrah today. You look at the poor countries, you know, they spend their entire life preparing for this journey, saving. And even a small percentage of our societies are actually able to make it to Hajj and Umrah. It's very expensive. So we might have the intention to perform this good deed, perform this great pillar of Islam. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala controls matters. So it's not within our control. The last thing I'll say about that is, my wife met an old friend of hers, and this is a very profound lesson. There's a sister who came from Russia, and she went to Damascus, a city of knowledge in Syria, to study Islam. And she was a class fellow along with my wife. My wife spent only a few years and came back, but this particular sister, she studied at this prestigious school, Jami' Abi Nur. She finished the entire Sharia course, 8 years. She graduated with a degree in Islamic studies and Sharia. She memorized almost half of the Quran, fluent in Arabic, coming from Russia, a nation that doesn't speak Arabic. So she gained all of this knowledge that most of us only dream of. And then she spent 1 or 2 years teaching Quran in an Arabic country. So my wife recently found her on Facebook, thank God for Facebook. But she found her and she's living in Russia, and she told us that this particular sister, in wherever she lives, they're not allowed to speak about Islam. They're not allowed to go to the masjid and do a program like we're doing here. They're not allowed to have halaqas even within the privacy of their own homes. So here's a sister who learned all of this knowledge. And now she's not able to even share with her own family what she learned. The Quran, nothing. And even the Muslim community there, they're not into learning about the deen. They're not into challenging the authorities. I mean, officially it's banned. But also the climate of that area is no one speaks. If there's some isolated questions, they might answer the questions, but there's no culture there, there's no trend of teaching people Islam. So here is someone who has all this knowledge, doesn't have the opportunity like we do, just to share what we learn. So the point, brothers and sisters, is that we control what we do, but to a certain extent. Not entirely. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control. So He controls our lifespan. We don't control how long we live. We control to a limited extent what we do with our lives, but not entirely. And finally, our lifespan is mostly out of our control. I mentioned mostly out of our control because there are some limited things that you can do with your lifespan. And that's the last thing I'll mention, and we'll close with that. The Prophet ﷺ, he did mention that there are some things that do control the way we live and how we live and the quality of our lives. For instance, there are some things that are physical and some things that are spiritual. So among the physical things that do have an effect on our lifespan to a limited extent is taking medicine, taking care of our health, eating properly, taking care of our physical bodies. Now if you take a person who takes care of his health, you know, takes medicine, you know, eats properly, does everything right to take care of his health, and then you have compare that to another person who doesn't take care of his health, he engages in risky behavior, when he's sick he doesn't help himself, he doesn't do what's required, and he does all of these wrong things with his life. Chances are the person who's taking care of his health is going to live longer than the person who isn't. And we have many examples of people who aren't, you know, smoking for instance, drinking alcohol, engaging in drugs, dying at young ages. So these things do have an effect. But the difficulty is that as Muslims, we know that our lifespan is determined. But what kind of effect do they have? We have to understand, the best way to understand it is how one companion asked the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Prophet answered in the best way. He said, the question was, أَرَأَيْتَ رُقَى نَسْتَرْقِيهَا. O Messenger of Allah, do you see the ruqya or the supplications, the du'as that we make? وَدَوَاءً نَتَدَاوَى بِهِ. And the medicine that we take. وَتُقَاتًا نَتَّقِيهَا. And the precautions that we take in our lives. هَلْ تَرُدُّ مِنْ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا. They asked the Prophet, does that change the destiny or the decree of Allah in the least? And the Prophet ﷺ, he said about medicine, about supplications, du'a, and so on and so forth. He said, هِيَ مِنْ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Rather, that is part of the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah created disease and He created medicine. Allah created all these physical means for us to take care of our health. And the best understanding of that was Umar ibn al-Khattab. You remember when he went to, there was a plague, an epidemic, an infectious disease that was plaguing a region of Damascus or region of Sham, Syria. And more than 10,000 companions lost their lives. And he was intending to travel to that region. And he stopped at the outskirts of the land and he made like consultation with his companions and he asked them, what should we do? All these people are dying with this land. So some of them said, you know what? This is part of Allah's destiny. If it's written for you to die, you will die. If it's not, you won't. So you should go ahead. And others said, no, take your precautions. So eventually he decided to leave. He decided not to enter Syria. And someone asked him, أَفِرَارًا مِنْ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ يَا عُمَرُ. They asked him, are you running away from Allah's decree, O Umar? And he said to them beautiful words. He said, نَفِرُّ مِنْ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ إِلَىٰ قَدَرِ اللَّهِ. We are running from the decree of Allah to the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In other words, nothing is outside the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So part of the things that does affect our lifespan are taking medicine and taking care of our physical health. And lastly, there are some spiritual things the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned that also affect our lifespan. So among those things, the most important thing is maintaining family relations. You know, maintaining ties of kinship and family. So the Prophet said in a sound hadith, مَنْ سَرَّهُ أَنْ يُبْسَطْ لَهُ فِي رِزْقِهِ أَوْ يُنْسَأْ لَهُ فِي أَثَرِهِ فَلْيَصِلْ رَحِمَهُ. He said, whoever desires that his provision be made abundant and that he live a long life, what should he do? He should maintain the ties and kinship. He should maintain family relations. Take care of your family, your parents and your family members. That has an effect on your lifespan, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he mentioned. Also among the things that he mentioned that have an effect is dua and righteous deeds in general. He said in a hadith from At-Tirmidhi, لَا يَرُدُّ الْقَضَاءِ إِلَّا الدُّعَاءِ. That nothing changes destiny or averts destiny except dua or supplication. وَلَا يَزِيدُ فِي الْعُمُرِ إِلَّا الْبِرِ. And nothing increases your lifespan except righteousness. So all of these things, they do have an effect on our lives, but it's not the ultimate destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ultimately, Allah wrote what is going to happen. what we're going to use, what dua we're going to make, what medicine we're going to take, what treatment we're going to endure. Allah knows all of that, and it's written in Lawh al-Mahfuz. But there's an aspect of destiny that does change based on what we do. So these are the consequences of our actions, and there's nothing wrong with desiring a long life. So going back to the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, "Tuba liman tala umruhu wa hasuna amaluhu." Glad tidings to the one whose life is very, very long and whose deeds are very, very good. So we as believers, we need to make sure that we do take advantage of the time that we have, the lifespan that we have, and take advantage of the opportunities for good that we have before it's too late. Because ultimately at the end of our lives, what's going to matter is what we did with our lives, not the length of our lives. Allah is not going to ask that, except in the form of asking us what we did with all of the days and all of the years that we were given. All of us want to live long lives. Nothing wrong with asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to live a long life. Now, even the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he made dua for one of the companions, Anas bin Malik. He made dua that, oh Allah, bless him in his provision, bless him in his family, and make him live a long life of good deeds. So the Prophet made this dua for Anas bin Malik. And how long did he live? Anyone know how old he was when he died? 106. Well, most of the reports mention 103. So Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu, he lived a long and productive life. Such a huge narrator of hadith. You can't pick up any book of hadith without mentioning his name, without reading his name, transmitting the hadith from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And what was his life? As a little child, his mother had brought him to the Prophet, and the Prophet had made dua for him to give him a long life. So we as believers, we should desire a long life. There's nothing wrong with that. So we should desire that, but with the ultimate purpose of taking advantage of that life and living a long life. So, you know, the best way to understand that, and we'll end with that, one of the scholars, At-Tibi, he said, a long life is like your capital. It's like an investment. You're an investor. The more money you have to invest in a business, the greater your profit. So the more years that a believer has, the greater his ranks with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because every good deed that we perform, we get closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those of us who live longer lives have greater opportunity to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us those who live long and productive lives, lives that are filled with barakah and blessing and good deeds. With that, if there's any questions or comments, we'll open the floor. Yes.
What about the person who lives long, but he's impaired in very